parts of India are regularly, you know, impacted by drought. So government of India since 60s and 70s had some investments in drought prone areas in different forms of programs, either desert development program or drought prone areas development program, integrated waste development program, wasteland development programs. So 60s, 70s, 80s, we have so many such programs, they were all implemented, and over a period of time, there were reviews about these programs at central government level, and then since 1994, all of them were put together and watershed development programs emerged. These programs were, watershed development programs were quite innovative and almost revolutionary in the government sector, because for the first time in India, they put money directly in the accounts of people's company. You know, till then, if you look at any development investment, you know, either it roads, buildings, irrigation, power, whatever you take, everything is executed through contractors. People never got funding from government directly. Somebody else will implement and people will benefit from that infrastructure. Unlike that kind of trend, watershed programs allowed people to form their own committees and receive grants from government and execute all the programs according to their own plans. So that was a major policy shift in terms of operational arrangements. So several NGOs are also part of this, and these programs also got reviewed several times. Since 1994, we have almost 25 years of experience. So while these programs are all happening, several times these programs guidance changed. You know, currently the situation is we are almost at zero. You know, it's almost like traveling the full circle and then reaching zero again. It's almost such a sad situation. I would like to mention why we arrived at such a kind of zero sum game in that sense. The main idea, as I mentioned, it is largely to look at people's own initiative, fund them so that they conserve natural resources, starting from land, water, forest, livestock, and other resources there. Over a period of time, the livelihoods agenda was integrated into the same program by providing additional component, which will be accessed by local poor women groups or livestock traders, or anyone who is with little disadvantaged background. That money is exclusively allocated to disadvantaged communities within the rural, within the watershed area, because watershed programs are always critical as, you know, a farmers program or land owners program. Whatever investment goes, that goes only to farmers, and landless people are not benefited. That has been the constant critique. Sometimes you don't know whether the critique is really genuine or not. You know, for example, a hospital is established, it's only cures ill people, sick people. You cannot argue that, you know, healthy people are not covered. You know, it's like that. When land resources and water resources are being developed, there is little opportunity for landless people unless government changes the entire system of land ownership and allocates land to them. So any other arrangement will be superficial. You know, you can give them some loans, you can give them some kind of cattle or whatever, but it will still not address the problem of land ownership. But anyway, watershed programs got that kind of critique for a long period. And then government tried to address those programs and those issues by allocating additional resources for landless people, additional resources for livestock, women, all that kind of issues. While these are all happening, the program got quite a big of, quite a huge demand in terms of its results. You know, people wanted moon out of it, you know, everything should happen in these villages and things like that. So the typically, the government of India and all state governments executed this program by partnering with several implementing agencies. Majority of them were government implementing agencies like Forest Department, Irrigation Department, Agriculture, Soil Conservation Department. And in some states like Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, there are Orissa, there are large number of NGO partners also who executed these programs as implementing agencies. While this is all going on, while the criticism was also growing, you know, the program guidance changed over a period of time, and it added more elements to it, and it became a kind of huge program over a period of time. But subsequently, some of the inherent limitations of this particular program is the program excessively focused only on conservation of water, and then everything is focused on either construction of dams or compounds or check dams or big tallows like that. And that in a way created huge groundwater resource and also surface water bodies across the villages where these programs are implemented. But how to utilize this water? You know, water is augmented, groundwater, surface water. How to access that, that remained always a challenge. And watershed policy really did not address that particular point. They said our main mandate is conserving water and soils and not promoting utilization of water. That is irrigation department's mandate. So this kind of division created quite a bit of challenge in that sense. Though there is water either below the ground, above the ground, people had to struggle to get that water. So the easy option was to put boreholes. So you can typically find in several watershed villages, after second year, third year, the number of borewells increased by 3 times or 4 times also. Particularly in places like Mahabubnagar, Anantapur, and then also you know, states like Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, the number of borewells after bore watershed program implemented just doubled, tripled, sometimes even 4 times. So a typical investment, I used to do this calculation in all watersheds wherever we executed along with our partners, before and after. If the village had some 30 boreholes before and irrigating through groundwater, say some 60 acres of land or so, you know, after watershed program, number of acres that got irrigation differently increased to say 300, 400 acres, but number of boreholes also increased to say from 30 to 150, you know, 100, like that. It's almost, you know, 2-3 times. And this is all coming from people's pockets. And this is a private investment. You know, it's a contradiction or some kind of paradox where government is putting money for conserving, you know, augmenting resources, and individuals are putting money to anyway exploit that water resources. So this paradigm, this kind of paradox was dominating the theoretical paradigm of watershed program. So from WASSAN side, all of network members, we were constantly arguing with government, you know, put some resources for community-based water utilization systems also, so that you are able to address this issue in a collective manner instead of allowing private investments to make public good as a private resource ultimately. So, and it is not regulated. I'm assuming that most of you are familiar with natural resource related policies of the government, particularly groundwater. It is not regulated. Even if it is regulated through some act and all, the actual act of regulation is fairly weak in many states. So, it is absolutely impossible to regulate groundwater exploitation, which is in the hands of large number of farms. So it's very difficult to control it. So government always says it is revenue department's mandate or irrigation department mandate. It's not part of watershed program. You know, that kind of, you know, passing on the buck took place over a period of time. And then farmers, you know, typically a typical watershed village would have in a 10 year cycle, you may have some good 3 years monsoon and 7 years are always drought. That is how watershed programs, that is why watershed programs go there. So when there is a good monsoon, groundwater, surface water, everything is augmented. Because of so many new boreholes, everything is simply consumed within 1 year also. And then because of this new access to augmented water resources, the agriculture pattern also shifted in many of these places. They started growing paddy and sometimes even banana, water consuming crops. Earlier, most of these villages were growing rain-fed crops like millet, pulses, and other crops. But now they shifted to irrigation-based crops, which is following some kind of green revolution paradigm. As a result, that model is imposed on drought-prone areas, drought-prone villages, and then agriculture changed. Groundwater consumption increased, and then that became quite a bit of gamble because so many borewells are there, you don't know how long each borewell exists, and then expenditure, investment cost in agriculture also increased because of crops. It created quite a bit of mess while government was intending to improve the, you know, water resources and land resources. So while government added livelihood components and all, the water utilization related instrumentalities are not inbuilt into watershed program. Or any other department did not accompany formally to see that water resources are properly regulated. Everything cannot come from watershed departments or program. But somebody should accompany that and see that these resources are properly utilized from sustainability part of view, continuity part of view. Somehow that opportunity is lost. As a result, we see, good monsoon, for example, 2016-17, there was a very good rainfall in Chittoor district in Andhra Pradesh. And that kind of rainfall was not there for the last 20 years. All water bodies got full. They are brimming with water, and it was such a beautiful thing to go there. But by November, everything is just exhausted. And it was there earlier scenario. So we see this kind of stories in so many places. We see the same story in Orissa. We see even rain, high rainfall zones like Tripura, Jharkhand. They also have similar issues because the regulatory systems for natural resources, either land, water, is fairly weak, and then investment goes only on conservation. So this is largely the problem side of the situation. I always thought that the policy and people, communities, farmers, everyone kind of had a very short term vision, and then in a way behaved in a very irresponsible way. So that is one part.